My name is Lasse Damper-Hardø. I am an AM specialist and electronics technician at Knorr-Bremse Rail System Denmark. We are at our Copenhagen workshop in our 3D printing department. Here we work mostly with reduction of obsolescence in train components. Instead of new production, we develop replacements for parts that can't be purchased from the original producers anymore. We make spare parts for all parts of the trains. Mostly we make for the internal components, but we also make for the combustion heating elements and for some of the safety and control equipment. We mainly use PETG, flame retardant PETG, and PC. Because we work on trains, also called rolling stock, we have to adhere to an EN standard that details specifically what type of flame retardant materials are allowed and which are not to be used on trains. When I started here, 3D printing wasn't a tool that was used, but we had some obsolete parts that we wanted to replace. And as I had some experience, I picked up and tried to make the parts with 3D printing.
Hello, my name is Martin Nyhøj. I'm an AM specialist and electronics technician. Here we have some parts that we are printing using AM manufacturing. We have printed battery covers for our hand terminals in the trains. They are obsolete, so we can't really buy them from the manufacturer anymore, so we have designed them ourselves. We also have printed a cabinet that we can't buy either, also due to obsolescence. We have printed the prototype on Prusa printers, and then we are having the cabinet or shell made with SLS. We also have a diode matrix for the IC3 trains info displays, where we can't buy the diode matrix anymore. So we have created a new version. And then we have printed a stronger gear for the oil burner ventilation on the IC4 train. The original part was very bad in the joint, so we have actually made a stronger version. Then we also made a DSD sign motor gear for the S train. Before we designed this part, we had a problem with when this part broke, we had to change the entire motor. But now, after we can print these parts, we only need to replace this and then the motor runs fine again. Then there's the emergency, like a converter for our emergency handle on the emergency inverter in the IC4, where we had problems with the top of them cracking due to the injection molding being very thin and the metal handle wasn't really adapted to match this. So we have designed a slightly different version for it, which can withstand the metal pressure. So this is a sensor for the oil burner on the IC4 train. And where there was backburn on the oil burner, this melts. And then we have to change the entire sensor. But now we have made this part, and now we only need to change this and the sensor part itself. So after making this part, we save about 50% instead of buying a new one. So this is a ATC balise. They are placed on the railroad tracks with a few hundred meters apart, and they are used to localize where the trains are on the network to make sure there aren't any collisions happening. And we have printed these anti-tamper seals. The reason for having the anti-tamper seal is to make sure that no one has actually tampered with them, as well as me having a guarantee from our side that the products work.
Our problem here is not finding more parts we want to print, it's finding time to invest into making these parts. The biggest issue with printing more things than we already do is approvals. We are constantly working on printing more parts. We are constantly working on getting more parts approved. When we develop a new part, our process is, of course, first we have to design it. Then we print a prototype. This prototype will be approved by the customer. After the customer has approved the prototype, all the necessary documentation will be made and collected about the part, schematics and certifications of materials. This will be sent to the technical department of the customer, and either it will be sent to the transport part of the government if needed, or otherwise it will be internally approved by the customer. Our approval process is in some cases very long, depending on who has to approve it. If it's a part the customer can approve, we can usually get it done in a few months. But if it has to go through the government, we have a precedence of about 6 months. We prefer using flame retardant PETG because it makes it a lot easier to get the components approved. My experience with Prusament has been very positive. I work with a lot of different material manufacturers, but the consistency of print quality has been exceptional with Prusament materials. The reason we are using enclosed printers is mostly because we also print in PC, and PC is a hard to print material, but with enclosures, it's a lot easier to get the temperatures to a point where the parts don't just pop off. We decided to use Prusa machines for two reasons. The first was we already had one in the building, so easy choice, go use it. The second was actually after the first year of use that we basically didn't have to service the machine. It just worked. So far we printed a bit on the Mark IV printer and we've been very impressed with the print quality. And we are looking forward to see how it holds up with the new nozzle system. The fact that you can change your nozzle and heat break in one go gives us a lot of hope for improving our flame retardant material printing. I've been very impressed with the automatic calibration feature. Press the button and it goes. That's always a nice feature.
So I like 3D printing because it's it makes everything a lot easier. Prototyping is very fast. Lead times can be reduced and it's also more sustainable since we can make specific parts for specific components instead of replacing the entire part.
3D printing in the railway industry is very much in its infancy so far, but I see more and more people in the industry show a lot of interest in it, and for good reason. Every technology you work with, of course, have its limits, but with an industry like 3D printing and all the different methods that are popping up and evolving, I only see these limits as small problems that have to be solved rather than problematic stops where we have to change technology.